Planetary boundaries are a framework or concept that describes in which levels the humanity's activities are going beyond the carrying capacity of our dear home planet. There are 9 of them, and I'm going to mostly address the most acute issue today, which is the climate change. Last time I checked, a couple of weeks ago, this was the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Around 420 parts per million. Parts per million sounds like a very, very, very small amount, right? But the last time we had similar amounts of carbon in the atmosphere, it was actually around 4 million years ago. And as we all know, carbon dioxide is like a warm blanket that warms the planet, and that, of course, causes snow and ice to melt. So the last time we had similar amounts of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, the sea levels, because of the melting of glaciers and snow and ice, were from 5 to 25 meters higher than they are today. So if we do nothing, if we are just happy with this level of emissions, and if we do not start removing carbon from the atmosphere, the impact is like 4 million years ago. Because carbon dioxide stays in the atmosphere for a very long time, for hundreds of years. So we have to do something. And this leads me to the construction sector's responsibility and also potential. It so happens that in Finland and in most countries, the built environment is accountable for 1/3 of all greenhouse gas emissions. And therefore, without very, very radical action in construction, and in the entire value chain of the built environment, we don't have a snowball's chance in Sahara, I'm sorry, to meet the climate goals of the Paris Agreement. And therefore, the International Panel on Climate Change has suggested that we should actually reduce the emissions in the construction sector by 80 or up to 90% by 2050. That's a huge number, so that's a challenge. So let's see how we are doing at the moment. So there's a big quest ahead. From 80 to 90% of emission reductions in construction by 2050, what is the current status, and more importantly, where are we heading to? So currently, we use around half of annual emissions, annual raw materials to construction. So construction is the most resource-intensive human action at the moment. And at the moment, there are several trends that actually are increasing the consumption of resources, not decreasing. So we had the quest of cutting the emissions by 90 or 80%, but instead, there seems to be a trend that drives us to an opposite direction. What are the reasons for this? Well, first of all, of course, there is the growing human population. By the end of the ongoing century, there is going to be 10 to 11 billion of us here. And most of the homes or hospitals or schools or streets for this growing amount of great new human beings are yet to be built. So there's going to be a need for lots of resources for just because of our headcount is growing. What makes this interesting in a global sense is that as we look at the typical floor area per capita, that also seems to be increasing. Here, on the left-hand side, we can see an average per capita floor area in different countries. It ranges from the sub-Saharan around 10 square meters per capita up to Australia's 80 square meters per capita. Finland is somewhere here in the middle, together with the United Kingdom, around 40 square meters per capita. But then when we look at the right-hand side picture, we can see that in many of those countries where there is a strong population growth, also the per capita floor areas are increasing. So we not only have more houses to be built, but people are living in larger apartments. And this is, in most cases, very well justified, because these people are building their way out of poverty. They are living in subhuman conditions, in slums, and in not so healthy apartments. So it's more than justifiable in many cases to let them build a better future. But of course, it comes with more resource consumption. And as a result, when we look at the size of cities, it has grown from 1975 to 2015 in a factor of 2.5, but from 2015 to 2050, it would grow in a factor of 3. So that's going to be a huge increase of resources and land area as well. Then we can also look at another driver, which is the number of natural disasters. As the climate is warming, the weather is getting more turbulent. And we can clearly see that there is actually quite a good statistical data about the natural disasters, how they have gone up as a function of the warming climate. So that's a driver that not only is worrying to the well-being and safety of humans, but it also adds to the renovation needs of the infrastructure that we are building. So we need to renovate buildings and infrastructure more often, which of course accelerates the use of resources for that, right? And as some of these factors, we can actually conclude that nowadays the consumption of construction materials is growing faster than the global population. Here on the right-hand side, we can see that there is more increase in the use of consumption construction materials than there is for the global population. So why are we so worried about then just the quantity of construction materials being consumed more? The reason is that these construction materials come with significant greenhouse gas emissions. And a couple of years ago, the International Panel on Climate Change stated that if we wanted to keep global warming within 1.5 degrees, then the remaining carbon quota would be somewhere around 500 gigatons of CO2 or below. Now, how do these trends of increasing use of construction materials, how do they correlate with this quest? Well, there is an unpleasant correlation. At the moment, the estimated emissions from the production of just cement, steel, aluminum, and plastics would cause, with current production technologies and consumption habits, almost two times as much emissions as we have in the budget by year 2050. And then we would also only have these four materials and nothing else. There is no quota for anything else, and still two times as much emissions that we could live with. But if we could turn our factories to utilize low-carbon energy, and if the factories could be very energy efficient in their processes, then probably we could push the figure down to around 550 gigatons, which is still too much, because it's only for these four key materials of the heavy industries. And the only chance that we would have then would be to apply radical measures of circular economy into construction, so that we can contain these emissions from main construction materials in a reasonable quota of planetary emissions. And next, I'm going to present you three suggestions of how this could be done. And these, of course, are not easy ones to achieve, but let's go through them anyway. First of all, I argue that we should seriously reconsider the needs for construction. Do we really have the budget in carbon terms to build more? Especially in countries where the population growth is steady, so the populations are not increasing, and where there are no acute humanitarian or natural disasters, we should seriously think twice before building anything new. And therefore, we should actually set this sort of hierarchy for construction, in which the highest priority would be to build nothing. Just utilize existing spaces. Then the next preferred action would be to renovate existing spaces. The third preferred action would be to use the foundations of old buildings as platforms for new construction. And the least preferred option then should be to build new buildings. Normally, we are taught the other way around. When we study architecture or building design or structural engineering, the tasks often start from the quest of building a new building. But because of the planetary consumption trends, we have seen that that's not sustainable anymore. And hence, we should really consider that how much can we build? If we need to build, and especially when we need to renovate, I argue that actually we should build from our own waste. What do I mean by this? There's actually a lot of stuff going into the built environment every year, and there are very, very, very tiny flows that are getting back to the industry that feeds the built environment. So the circulation rates are marginal in comparison to the use of virgin raw materials. And therefore, we should try to get towards closed or almost closed material flows in the built environment. I'll show you some examples. This is from Copenhagen. It's a building that's actually made from old windows. All these windows here, these are old windows from buildings that are disassembled in the great Copenhagen area, and with the help of algorithmic design, the architects have assembled them into the building's facade and created nice new architecture. Okay, so reusing old building products would be something that we'd like to do. But there's another take of building from waste, and that's wood. As we probably all are familiar with, wood is made from the atmospheric carbon. When trees are growing, they are absorbing CO2 from the atmosphere, and half of the dry mass of wood or other bio-based materials is actually carbon. So actually, trees are eating our pollution, our waste from the atmosphere, and the more we can build out from wood and other bio-based materials, the more we are actually building from the waste that our factories polluted. But it's not only wood. We also have very promising opportunities of using technically captured carbon to cure concrete or to make other products. And if we could make the entire built environment a huge carbon bank or carbon storage, we will be much better off in our fight against the climate change. And my third suggestion to you would be that actually, I think we should question our current anthropocentric construction culture. You see, today, as we have already concluded, we are using half of annually extracted raw materials for construction, and we are about to consume even more. And as we are consuming these raw materials, we are not only causing emissions and pollution, but actually, we are taking those raw materials from the habitats of other forms of life that are sharing this one home planet of ours. So let's imagine that you would like to make a new, whatever, sauna or summer cottage, and you probably wouldn't go to your neighbor's site and start disassembling his home and taking building materials and for your own good, right? That's a no-go. And I fully acknowledge that this is philosophically a difficult question, but why is it so that it's okay for humans to go to the homes of non-humans and take stuff from there and, you know, try to handle with our needs? Could we, instead of this sort of behavior that has triggered the sixth mass extinction of species, instead see ourselves as not the dominator of this planet, but one nice neighbor in this planetary neighborhood? Who knows if our planet is the only one who has complex life? If it would be so, then I think that our responsibility for the well-being of other forms of life in this tiny rock that circles our closest star is even greater. So, to conclude, I argue that in the future, in construction, we would have to live with less. So it's inevitable that we would have to do more with less impacts and less resources. There is just no way that we can share the pie for growing population if we continue like this. To do this, we should of course try to reuse and recycle not only building materials, but their elementary components such as carbon as effectively as possible. But because these are actually quite difficult, then I think that the essential enabler would be compassion. We should need to be compassionate to ourselves and to our fellow human beings with whom we are trying to go through this great transition, because it's a very difficult one. But if we love our planet then I think that we can succeed. Thank you very much for your attention.